I know what they say, but 2 Kings, the 20th chapter. Now, that's in the Old Testament scripture here. Ought to be about the 12th book in the Old Testament scripture. Right between 1 Kings and 1 Chronicles in the Old Testament. You all have a Bible. If you don't have one, then we got some. I'll put them out starting next week. You can, we got some. I think you ought to read with the preacher.
Amen.
And that way you can know for yourself.
Yes.
Amen.
And 2 Kings, the 20th chapter.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to... begin reading at verse number 1.
All right.
Amen.
All right.
It said, in those days was Hezekiah sick unto death.
Yeah. All right.
And the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, came to him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order. Mm-hmm, for thou shalt die and not live. Yes, sir. And then he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. It came to pass after before Isaiah was gone out into the middle court, that the word of the Lord came to him, saying, turn again and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, thus said the Lord, the God of David thy father, I have heard thy prayer, I have seen thy tears, and behold, I will heal thee. On the third day thou shalt go up to the house of the Lord, and I will add unto thy days 15 years. I will deliver thee and this city out of the hand of the king of the city, and I will defend this city for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. And Isaiah said, take a lump of fish.
Yeah.
And they took and laid it on the ball.
Lord. Thank you.
And he recovered. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
The book said, amen, that he turned his face to the wall. And Isaiah, God told Isaiah, turn again and tell Hezekiah.
Yeah.
If you turn to the Lord, he'll turn to you. If you, as an individual, personally, it works for everybody, I'm saying, will turn to the Lord will turn to you. I got a scripture that says, draw nigh or near unto God, and God draw near unto me. Some way, somehow, humanity has many things just outright backwards. And there are things that we ought to do at certain times, and seem like when we ought to do it, that's when we don't do it. Y'all ain't sad. And when we ought not do it, that's when we do it. And it just seemed like with all of the turmoil and the trouble and the strife in the world, now it just seemed like folk would be trying to get as close to God as they could. And yet folk are getting further from God than they have ever been. Y'all ain't saying nothing. In other words, back in the day when grandmama them thought things were hard, and they called on the name of God, and they honored God, and when the church seemed like things are far worse now than they ever had been, and folks still will not turn to God. And then there are some folk that do go to church, don't misunderstand me. There are some full churches this morning, but there's still not folk that's turning to God. We're turning to the preacher, y'all ain't saying. We're turning to the choir, we're turning to the music, and we're turning to our auxiliaries, but I'm talking about turning to the living God who got all power. See, all boil down, I don't care how good the preacher is, he can't save nobody but himself. Y'all ain't saying that. I don't care that certain things folk just can't do for you. And when we're at the cemetery, they always tell us, the funeral director always say, we have gone as far as we can go with whoever this is. And I want you to know that God says, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world. So when Mama has gone as far as she can go, and we've gone as far as we can go, he's still with me. I said, when others have got to their departure point, you always say that. You know, when you're seeing folk off on the plane, they ain't gonna let you go for so far. You don't have a ticket. You're not going to the gate. You're not going behind this place. You just gotta bid them farewell at a safe point. And folk can only go so far with you, but that's never a place that you can go where God can't get in. You always say that. Got to a place,
amen,
where God had to say, I gotta be.
Amen.
Amen. You understand that?
Yes, sir.
I take them folk to the airport, and as much as you wanted to see them get on the plane, they wouldn't let you get that close.
Amen.
And if you don't have a ticket, they'll tell you this is a busy farewell right here in front of this line. Y'all ain't saying that. But God says, I'm with you.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Always.
Yes, he is.
Even to the end of the world.
Amen.
He said on another occasion, I'll never forget you. He says, I have engraved on the palm of my hand. Y'all understand? See, you got purple tattooed on you, but he said, I have engraved you on the palm of my hand. Never will I forsake you. You done engraved some folk on you, and y'all are broke up. Y'all ain't saying that. Now you looking for an eraser. Y'all ain't saying that. He says, I have engraved you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you.
All right.
But don't you twist it. We have left him.
Yeah.
And we have forsaken him.
Amen.
And the fact that you won't do right don't make God be wrong. Y'all understand that? God is still God. And the fact that you don't love him, he still loves you. Amen.
Amen.
In fact, he loves us when we don't know how to love ourselves.
Amen.
We are headed
for
destruction on an express ride.
Yeah.
He still loves us.
Hallelujah.
We bring harm to ourselves, to our loved ones and friends. He still loves us, and he still reaches out to us. And it's a good day to turn to him.
All right.
The one who says, come unto me.
Amen.
All ye that labor with life. And I have the labor. Those of you who have tried everything else. Some folk, I'm not a judge of people, and I try to understand things people do, even if I don't do them, but some stuff just ought to be old now. Y'all ain't saying that. Some stuff you ought to just be tired of. You know the end result. You know how it works. You ought to just be tired of it. I keep telling folks, you're just like on the merry-go-round of life. In other words, we can get on there and we know it's going to make us busy. Y'all ain't saying that. And it ain't doing nothing but going round and round and round. But it feels good in a weird kind of way. Y'all ain't saying that. It's something about it that still make you get on there. You can look at the foundation and the construction of a merry-go-round.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, Lord.
And you can know before you ever get on it exactly where it's going to go. So otherwise, you can't get on a merry-go-round out there and wind up on the east side. Y'all ain't saying that. Y'all better hit me. I'm going to be through in a minute. I'm preaching now, you see.
All right.
You get on a merry-go-round out here, and if you stay on it you're all day and all night,
all right.
You're still going to be right here.
Yeah.
When I was in the army, we used to do, they had a command called March Time Mark.
Yeah.
All right.
You know about that.
Amen.
And when they tell you to do that, you just was marching in place.
Yeah.
Really, you just exercising. If you did that for 30 minutes, when you finished, you'd have marched 30 minutes, but you're still in the same spot.
Yeah.
And some of us been doing that same thing. Y'all ain't saying that. We've been in the same cycle. We know where the hurt gonna come in. We know what day we gonna get a black eye. Y'all ain't saying that. We know what day we gonna get put out. We got it all the way down. Instead of getting out the merry-go-round, we said faster.
Amen.
In our text, I better talk about this a little bit. The Bible gives us a story of a king by the name of Hezekiah.
Yes.
Who history says for a whole 100-year time period in Judah, Hezekiah was the only faithful king in all of Judah. He had none like his predecessors. He had torn down idol groves, discontinued idol worship in the nation, and turn the people's hearts toward a living God. He had reformed the nation in many ways, had fortified them and protected them from the various enemies that came against them. And most of all, the book says that he had an effective prayer life. And he was close to God. I've told you time and time again, whenever you have a king that was a righteous king, then generally speaking, the nation was a righteous nation. But whenever a king was wicked, the people were just as wicked as the king was. And it's like church. That's why some folk take pleasure in catching the preacher wrong and knowing that the preacher's doing all sorts of stuff. Because if he's doing everything, he can't say nothing about what you're doing. Y'all ain't saying that. But I'd much rather find somebody who's got a heart towards God, somebody who's trying to live right, so that I can know the truth and tell me the truth, whether I'm ready to live it or not. And when I get ready to live it, I know how to live it. I won't be confused.
Amen.
Oh.
Amen.
Truth don't bother me. The truth helps me.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'm caught right in it.
Yeah.
But you ain't got to lie to me. You don't have to fool me. You don't have to play with it about it. Just tell me the truth and I know what I got to work on. Somebody tell you you got a wife cooking for you and she can't cook, don't tell a baby who we that's good. talking about you don't want to hurt her feelings. I don't want to hurt my stomach. Somebody. The Bible says you'll know the truth now. Yeah. The truth will make you free.
Yeah.
Some of us can't get free because we'd rather believe a lie. Y'all ain't saying we'd rather hear a lie than hear the truth.
Yeah.
And the truth of the matter is, no matter where you are, you don't have to stay there. It's in there, that's your choice.
Yeah.
There's a better way.
Amen.
Some of us, the older we get, here the problem comes. That's why you can get little children to be baptized, because the older we get, the more comfortable we get with being who we are and how we are. And that's our claim to fame. That's just how I am.
Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. What's right then to bring your defense is, that's just how I am. It is how you are, but is it how God wants you to be? See, God is the creator. He created us for this purpose. And whenever we cannot live to that purpose, he's got every right to allow us to die. If you get some, I got some German shepherds. I got them just to breed them, you understand, so I can sell them. And if I get out there and catch them where they can't coagulate and make no babies, then I don't need them. Just going to say on the dog food for nothing, y'all ain't selling. You make God create us for his purpose. We can't live to God's purpose. And he ought to just keep us and just keep waking us up and keep feeding us and keep protecting us and keep giving us chance after sin. We don't gonna do nothing. You know that don't make sense.
Yeah.
Tell the truth. You know it has no logic to that.
Amen.
You know what you would do. You know what you would say.
Yeah.
Lord. Hezekiah had a heart towards God.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And he corrected a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
Lord.
That other kings had let get out of hand.
Lord.
In fact, Hezekiah's own father, who preceded him as king.
Yeah.
And allowed it to get so bad.
Yeah.
Till they said the temple doors were nailed shut.
My Lord, my Lord.
And we ain't far from it. Don't y'all beat my Lord too hard. And then had shut the temple doors. In other words, there was no worship.
Yeah.
But Hezekiah knew about God. Went in and cleaned and restored and rebuilt and started and caused the Passover again to be a national holiday. But in all the good that you do, at some point, you're still going to have to leave him. The brother said earlier, at some point, you're still going to wind up at the end of the road. So the Bible said that Hezekiah became sick.
Yeah, yes, sir, yes, sir.
And I'm not talking about no migraine.
My God.
Or no sinus infection.
All right.
But the book said he was sick unto death.
Man. My God.
And God, who don't let nothing slip up on you.
Yeah. All right, all right.
Amen. Amen.
Told Isaiah the prophet, go and tell King Hezekiah to get his house in order.
Yeah.
And don't just tell him to get his house in order, but tell him, I said, he's going to die and not live.
Amen.
And this story is also recorded in the book of Isaiah, the 38th chapter, but This account had a few more details.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a stickler for details. He told him, set your house in order.
Yeah.
That's right.
You're going to die and not live.
Amen.
Now, my doctor's name is Dr. Greenlee.
All right.
And if Dr. Greenlee told me that,
yeah,
I'd go get a sample of it.
Right.
And I would maybe even chance around with it, because the doctor can only give you what they call a prognosis. And what they're doing is estimating how long you have based on how long other folk had who had the same condition that you have. Y'all understand that? They looked at other folk and said, well, you understand, some more folk died from this. And generally, if it was this bad, this is how long they had it. And oftentimes, when the doctor gives you a prognosis, a lot of times the doctor is not quite so right about it. You understand, you can escape that, you can laugh sometimes. In fact, sometimes you can outlive the doctor that told you you were going to die. Y'all ain't saying that. Sometimes, because the doctors are practicing medicine, and they're righteous so they can practice. That means they ain't never got a
perfection.
Yeah, they said they can practice. But God,
amen.
I ain't talking about Dr. Greenlee now. I'm talking about, you know, big God.
Yeah.
You see, the doctor done studied the body. They done took anatomy and biology, all them sciences that I flunked. They done took all of that, and they know all about the body.
Yeah.
But they didn't create the body. Sometimes they see bodies that don't come up to nothing they saw in the book. Y'all understand? They see bodies and they can't remember nothing they were put in school that would help them with the body that they're looking at in front of them. But the God we serve, He created us. He made, the Bible said He made the number of hairs that are on your head. He knows all about us and He made us. So if He says you're finna die, God says to Isaiah, go tell Hezekiah to set his house in order.
Yes.
He's going to die.
Yes, sir.
My Lord.
And not live.
My Lord.
And Isaiah, or Hezekiah, didn't get in no conversation with Isaiah.
That's right.
So Isaiah was just a messenger. Whether Isaiah sympathized or not, he couldn't keep Hezekiah from dying.
Amen. That's right.
So the Bible said that Hezekiah turned his face to the wall.
All right.
In other words, he was turning his face away from Isaiah. Y'all ain't saying that. He was turning his face away from the message, away from the problem. See, where we mess up, we keep looking at the problem. And you can't never look a problem away. You can't never look at a problem long enough to make it just move. Y'all understand that? You keep looking and it's still there. And after a while, it look worse than it did at first. Y'all better get this. Isn't that easy?
My Lord, my Lord.
You know, sometimes when people write you a letter, and you read the letter, and you sit it down, and then you, for some reason you keep going back to reading the same letter. They ain't wrote nothing else. You just still keep reading the same letter. I've done that before. You know, if somebody break up with you and they write it on a letter, and you keep reading it. By the time you read it the fourth time, it looks like they broke up with you twice in the same letter. quit me before she quit me. You know, because it don't get no better. You know what I'm saying? You just keep looking at your problems, and your problems don't get no better because you're looking at them, because you're focusing on them. And we have to learn how to look away from the problem and look to the problem solver. For the psalmist says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills from where my help comes. All of my help comes from the Lord. And since I know that whenever problems arise, I'm not looking at the problem. Y'all ain't saying that. The book says he is a prophet. In times of trouble. Isaiah, Hezekiah turned his face to the wall. The book said that he prayed unto the Lord. And I know for who I'm convinced. If it would have happened today, before they ever said a word to God, they'd have to solicit their Facebook friends, y'all ain't saying nothing, to pray for them. They didn't have to tell them, you understand, I got bad news, and I need you to pray for me. And I reckon you can't never get too much prayer. But I ain't gonna trust Facebook, you know what I'm saying, man, to be my main source of prayer. I need somebody who's been before God. And they, the old folks have a saying, they used to say, those who can get a prayer through, pray for me. They didn't ask everybody to pray for them. They said, those who can get a prayer through. In other words, those who've got a relationship with God. See, what prayer is having a relationship with God that says to God and to people that me and God are in a relationship. So I need something I'm comfortable asking God for, and I feel like God will do it. That's just like you. You got friends who have friends that's not your friend. And sometimes you can need something that your friend's friend has. And you ask your friend to ask his friend. Y'all ain't said that. You ask your friend to ask his friend about it. You don't ask the person you don't have a relationship with.
Right.
Because your chances are decreased.
Yes, sir.
So you tell your friend to ask his friend. See, because otherwise, the person ain't doing it on the strength of you. They're doing it on the strength of the one that they have the relationship with. And that's why some folk can get a prayer through and some folk can't. Because when you got a relationship with God, when you come accustomed to getting up, telling God, good morning, telling God, thank you for letting me see another day, for telling God, I have done what you told me to do. That's no harm. That's no shame. That's no nervousness about coming before God.
Hallelujah.
I hear folks that pray for me. And I don't ever want anybody to think I take it lightly or that I'm being funny, but I always want to know, have you prayed for yourself?
Right.
Yes, sir.
See, if you think I got some favors due from God, I don't want to spend up all my favors on somebody who ain't got no favors with him. You can get to know him for yourself. He said, whoever will can come to him. Y'all ain't saying that. You get your own relationship with him, and you ain't got to rely on somebody else praying for you. You can just talk to God just like you talk to anybody. But some of us are just like some of us.
Amen.
When folks and folk call you, you see the number.
Well.
If you're broke, ain't no need to ask them. So if you don't want to talk to them, they don't want to talk to you. They just needed something. Y'all ain't saying. When you see the number, you already know they didn't just call to see how you doing. That's our logic, and we got called out there. Sometimes people can switch up on you. They'd be like, let me see your phone, man.
Yeah. All right.
And they hit you from another phone. But look, we kind of use call out there and stuff, man. God already knew our heart.
Oh, yeah.
He already knows some of us ain't gonna call till we need some. He already knows some of us is gonna miss many opportunities to tell him thank you. Some of us are gonna be too ashamed to praise him. Some of us just not gonna have time for him. He already understands that. So when you do get ready to pray, I can see why you would say pray for me. Y'all ain't saying that. But the way that works, eventually your friend, you know who you ask it on behalf of, that friend is going to eventually say, tell him to buy his own.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Right.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
When you have a relationship with God,
oh, yes.
Well, I know you can't see him, but you can talk to him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
And he has given us this word right here.
Amen.
And he speaks back to us.
Yeah.
Right, right.
And you saying, no, he don't. I ain't never heard him.
Yeah.
You hadn't read it right. And you hadn't read it and prayed.
Yeah.
Because if you will seek him, man. Now listen, I didn't say it, quoted and cited.
Right,
and see,
right, right.
When we go to the funeral and the people keep reading the 23rd Psalm, the reason the people still crying because they didn't do nothing for them last week when you read it at the other funeral.
Right,
they
right.
need something else that's pertaining right now to today. Y'all ain't saying that. And God's word is a rhema word. It's a living word. And what happens when you leave the book closed on the shelf? It doesn't do anything. But when you open it and read it the way God has it, it comes to life. The book says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God, and that word became flesh and dwelt among us. So in other words, the word still can do whatever the word wants to do. So when you're sitting here reading the word and your heart and your mind is lining up with God, God will speak to your heart. And you don't have to know what chapter to turn, just turn to one.
Amen. Thank you.
Because whatever God wants you to know, he can put it on any page in there. But it has to start somewhere. You have to make up in your mind that what I'm doing, I'm just burning up time. I'm just burning daylight. I'm just wasting time. Y'all ain't saying I'm just spinning my wheels. I can't kill nothing more than die. I'm not going nowhere. I'm not there at all. Would you really just think about it while I'm talking?
Yeah.
See, some folks like a lot of noise, and they be telling you 15, 8, or 10. I don't want you to do it. I just want you to think.
Yeah. Amen.
About what you've been doing and how you've been doing it, how far they got you. Father, you could be if you tried something.
All right,
that's enough. Hezekiah,
yes, sir.
Turned his face to the wall.
Yeah.
And Bible said he straightway prayed to the Lord.
Amen.
Saying, I beseech you, I beg you, O Lord, to remember.
Yeah.
I have walked before you in truth and with a perfect heart.
Yeah.
How I have done what was right and good in your sight.
Yeah.
And the Bible said Hezekiah wept so.
Yeah.
You know his prayer. He didn't do the Deacon Jones prayer.
All right.
You know, thou eternal God our Father who scooped down and grabbed a lot of nothing and slung it out and the hemisphere somewhere and made something. He didn't do all that.
Amen.
It said he was sick unto death.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
God said, set your house in order.
Yes, yeah.
You're going to die and not live.
Amen.
So he cut through the chains.
All right.
Yes,
and started calling God like he really needed him.
Right.
Some folks say, I don't know how to pray. You know how to talk.
Right.
Prayer is just communicating with God.
Amen.
Telling God what's in your heart.
Yes.
And I know what you're saying. He already knows. Yeah, the Bible said he know what you have need of before you even ask.
Yeah.
But the same Bible says you have not because you ask not. When you ask amiss. You ask it in the wrong way, with the wrong attitude, with the wrong mindset. Y'all know what I'm saying? But Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and began to pray to God.
Sure enough.
Reminding God of what he had done.
Amen.
And in order for you to not miss letting him know how this works, he had to have already done something. He had already done some things that were pleasing to God to be able to call God on those things. Amen, somebody. In other words, we don't live right just to be living right. We don't do right by people just to say we did right. Y'all ain't saying that. But God says, as you would men do unto you, do also unto them. So this is God's principle. And when you live by God's principle, you can get God's reward. So he said, remember now how I walked before you.
Yes.
And then the book said, Hezekiah wept so.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Isaiah had brought the message.
Yeah.
And the way the record is, when Hezekiah turned from him, Isaiah didn't stay to try to console him.
Amen.
But he left to go back where he came from.
Yeah.
And the book said before he even cleared the temple, before you know it don't take God ever to do nothing. Before Isaiah even cleared the temple, the Lord called and told Isaiah, turn that gear and go back to Hezekiah. And tell him that I have seen shut his tears. And I have heard his prayer. And I'm going to heal him. And on the third day, he'll be able to go to the house of the Lord. And also tell him that I'm going to add 15 more years to his life. And not only that, he said, tell him I'm going to deliver this city out of the hand of the Assyrians and defend it for my name's sake and for David's sake.
Yeah.
Now envision Hezekiah. When he got the news that he was about to die, only king that had been faithful in over 100 years. And didn't even have a son to inherit the throne. And God said, set your house in order because you're going to die and not live. Had done some reforms, but hadn't completed it. Had started a great work, but had not completed it. Was working on getting the people of God to worship him, but had not completed it. And recognizing that if I die right now, it's not going to just affect me, but it's going to affect the whole lot of people. I don't know how you think about it when you say, I ain't hurt nobody but myself. If you would have died now, would it just affect you? Y'all ain't said that. Or would it affect some other people? Would it affect them in a good way or And here the Lord says to set your house in order. You're going to die and not live. He didn't turn the man Agur with Isaiah, but he turned his face to the wall and began to call on the name of God. Some of us have gotten just as bad news. Maybe, didn't nobody say you're about to die. Maybe they just told you that you're about to lose your job. Maybe you found out that you were about to lose your home. Instead of turning to man, you ought to turn to God. The God that I serve, he's got all power. There's no that's ever too hard for God. Only God that I serve, he's able to do everything but fail. When trouble arrives, you ought to turn to God. Don't turn to drugs and don't turn to alcohol. They just magnify problems. They just cause you to not see them for a moment. But when you sober up, when you come to, the problem is still there. But the God that I serve,
somebody, when all hope is gone.
I just have turned to it. If you gotta turn to it with the bottle in your hand, just turn to it. And when he turns to you, he'll take the taste from you. He'll deliver you. He'll set your own straight for you. When it's popular now to do how you want to do it. It's popular now to just go where you want to go. But when you're on the job and the plant would have closed, had you not been on the job and had you not been faithful, the job would have been over except for your faithfulness. Wherever you are, whoever you are, and God will open doors for you. When other folk are losing, chapter. I know the time gonna come when these young people gonna forget about you. They gonna turn their tides and walk away from God. But Solomon said, when you get mad with them, if you shut up heaven, let there be no rain. If you call the locusts to come, which are called by your name, if they humble themselves and pray to you, if they turn from that wicked way, then will you hear us from heaven? And God answered the prayer and said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, turn from that wicked way, seek my face. He can't fix you. You gotta turn to God. But God ain't able. He can fix everything. Ain't able. So yeah. Turn to God.
Amen. Thank you, God.
Come to Him.
Yeah.
While you still have time.
Yeah.
I was at a funeral yesterday. And I'm glad y'all went there.
Amen.
Put that off. Because